commonplace. All kinds of diseases, people are slipping away. The economy's down, people can't get enough pay. But as for me, all I can say is thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Whoa, folks without home living out in the street, and drug habits, some say they just can't beat. Oh, muggers and robbers, no place seems to be safe, Lord, but you've been my protection every step of the way. I wanna say thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Hey, it could have been me.
That's what kind of morning we're having, a thank you, Jesus, morning for all that he's done for us. Come on, make sure that you tag and share. It is the Pivot Global Community and the Pivot Encounter this morning. God is good and he is amazing. For that, we say thank you. Come on, let's worship for just a few more minutes. And we're getting right into this morning's session. Good morning, Pivot Global family. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Come on, make sure that you tag and share this. Make sure that we're on it this morning. My God, why? Because we have so much to thank God for. So much to thank God for.
They just can't beat. Oh, muggers and robbers, no place seems to be safe, Lord, but you've been my protection every step of the way. I want to say thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Hey, it could have been me, outdoors, with no food and no clothes.
You get to thinking about that. I'm telling you all the things that you are thankful for. Now, there's a plethora of things that we could complain about, but think of all the things that you are thankful for, the times that God has made a way, your life, your health, your strength. This is Thanksgiving week, and we're entering into this week with thanksgiving, my God, and entering into his courts, huh? With praise. David was right. He says, I will bless the Lord at what? All times. And his praises shall continually be in my mouth. Why was he saying that? Because regardless of what kind of situation he says that I find myself in, there is always something to say thank you for. He said, I'm going to pull praise even out of a problem. I'm going to pull my praise out of a painful situation, because I know that the same God that allowed me to go in is the same God that's going to extract me from whatever I may find myself in. Good morning, y'all. Listen, a brand new week. We're thankful. We're grateful. Are you blessed this morning? My God, are you on top of your situation? My God, looking down at it. I'm telling you, these morning sessions are such a blessing. And to all of our guests and visitors, you won't be a guest and visitor too long, because we already consider you family. All right. Consider you family. It's a brand new week, Pivot Global Community. And my name is Cedric Nesbitt. I happen to be The lead executive here, the apostolic executive, and just thanking God for not only this community, but for our team and all that God has done. He's been so faithful to us right there. If we don't say nothing else this morning, he has just been so faithful, and we're grateful for that, right? I was looking back over some things the other day, and someone had sent me a message and says, just over a year ago, I started listening to and tuning in to the sessions and to the broadcast. And they said, I've been tremendously blessed. And I looked at that. And I said, wow, we've been setting the pattern in prayer, engaging in worship, engaging in intercession for over a year straight. Our assignment has not changed. We have not wavered. And you have been consistent no matter where you've got on the bus. That's right. My God, you are part of the family. And God is using this vehicle as a vehicle of empowerment and inspiration, a vehicle of transformation and change for so many lives. Guess what? We can't afford to stop now. Hang on in there. Buckle your seatbelt. The best is yet to come. All right? My God, I'm encouraged this morning and strengthened. I'm praying for you and your families. That's what we're going to do during this holiday season. Please know that we have a team of intercessors that wants to take your prayer request, wants to be involved in praying for you and making sure that God's finest is what you'll have and receive during this holiday season. And I'm going to ask you to submit your prayer request and show you where to do that so that during the holiday season, you'll have someone that's praying for you and yours, right? All right, we got a lot that's rolling, right? We want to invite those that are first timers. Put a number one in the feed if you're not ashamed about it. Put a one in the feed and let us know you're coming in for the first time. Family, thank you for tagging and sharing like you're crazy. Every Tuesday, we want to be purposeful in catching this live. And then, my God, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of the Lord. So we'll catch it on the rebroadcast as well because we understand it is what is growing us. And we want to invite every single one of you, if you have not already, right? Become a part. Everybody is not always going to get it the first time around, but we have people joining every single day. I had a couple of people yesterday to say, how do I get connected with you? I'm like, we're pivoters. So connect with the Pivot Global family and text 520-567-4188. Text Pivot to that number. And they said, I'm in. So I hope you are on the line today and that you're part of this because it was a pleasure speaking with you on yesterday. All right. Well, my God, we've got so many amazing things. Today is the launch of a couple things for us. And I want to mention this and we're getting right into this session. You don't want to miss today. Please invite somebody. I'm telling you in advance, something great is about to go down. And this is one of my favorite sessions that I love to do, especially around this time. And the Lord gave me something as it relates to this, that, and the other. You'll find out here in just a minute. We are getting ready to launch, my God, Christmas in Ghana. Christmas in Ghana. That's it. You'll be hearing about it from now until the 21st, I believe, December 21st. But our efforts are to make a difference and show love and support there in the town of Sandima, Ghana. Pastor Joy is the lead there in our African network there in Ghana and just doing a fine job. And we want to get behind them. Last year, we were able to contribute thousands of dollars to really be a blessing. And I had to repent the first year that we did this. This is going to be our third year. This is going to be our fourth year, doing this. And the first year I came into this, honestly, like, okay, let's get some toys. Let's get this, that, and the other. And, I missed the mark. I'll be honest with you. I missed the mark because this westernized mind was thinking westernized, right? Provision and Christianity and all that good kind of stuff. But in reality, he says, Apostle, can I be honest with you? And we put this elaborate plan together to do this and that and the other. And he says, really, if we can just provide food, if we can just provide food for the people and the villages, then that would be a great blessing. And so that's what we've been doing, food and provision and clothing. That is the dominant need for this year. You'll be hearing more about it. And I want each and every one of us. Pastor Joy, God bless you, sir. It's good afternoon from Ghana. I want each and every one of us to make a pledge, right? And to do the very best that we can. You'll be hearing more about this opportunity, but we want to come up to $3,500. I'm going to say that without being scaling back on it, be very intentional, $3,500, and that will go a long way there in Ghana, because one of our dollars equals six of theirs. So let's go, like my sons say, let's go crazy doing this. Why? Because we know that we're meeting a need, and God's going to be glorified in it. All right. I won't show you the video, but the video will be available, and a lot of the donation items and information will be available on our social media. Hey, family, let's attack this and let's reach our goal of $3,500. All right. Thank you in advance. I appreciate you. All right. Also, somebody say December 3rd, very quickly. December 3rd, all right, we're having an interest meeting, and this is going to be a physical meeting there in Amarillo, all right, there in Amarillo, Texas. That's right, December 3rd, we'll be in Amarillo, Texas at 7, I'm sorry, let's backtrack that, at 9 a.m., starts at 9 a.m., it's on Saturday, all right, and we're going to get together and talk about what the Lord is doing in that region, amongst others. But we're going to start right there. All right. Join me. If you've been asking, where is this going? How is this going? What's going on? What is God saying? What is God doing? If you need a word from the Lord, right? You need us to touch and agree with you in prayer, right? I believe the prophetic is going to be activated in this session. Join us for a morning session. And it's going to be amazing. You'll be getting information. There'll be a link for you to register for free. But put your name down, because we want to prepare for you in excellence. Does that make sense? All right, let's go. We got things to do. We got places to go. And we need you to be an active part of it. All right, we're going to our session this morning. Praise the Lord. Now, I could not get out of this. I tried. I really did try. And I said, Lord, can we just talk about something else? Because there's some things that we could be talking about and really leaning into. And this is what I want to do. And he said, He says, family matters, right? So we are sandwiched right back into this topic of discussion. And there's another part that, because I really believe that the Lord is really gearing our families up for something amazing. Come on. If you know that God is gearing you and your family up for something amazing, I just need you to put amazing in the feed very quickly. Amazing. Yeah, if he's gearing you and your family up for something amazing, I need you to put amazing in the feed very quickly. Amazing. All right. Yeah. All right. Today we're going to talk about conflict resolution. Conflict resolution. You better get somebody in here. This is good. I like talking about relationships and this, that, and the other. But around this particular time, you're going to need some keys, some tools, some overcoming power. For those that are dealing with people, we are all imperfect. I didn't say we were perfect. I said we're imperfect, trying to be perfected by God. And until we get there, we're going to need conflict resolution. All right, put that in the feed very quickly. Conflict resolution. All right. So I'm going to give you some scenarios, right? Let me give you some scenarios. I want to give you just some things really quickly. All right. Scenario number one, really quickly. Elaine is part of a small group setting, and she thoroughly enjoys her small group. Listen, her small group, and she attends it every week. She's found for it to be fulfilling and spiritually uplifting. coming out of an unhealthy past and just recently experiencing a breakup, she's really trying to get back to the place where she needs to be with God. But one night after the small group session, Elaine chats with her group leader, Manny. And after talking about the session, Manny asks her if she would like to go out with him on a date. Now, Manny is single. Elaine is conflicted. And she sits next to the small group session, sits in that small group session, trying to determine what she should do. All right. Now, these we're going to talk about later. So I want you to grab these scenarios and we're going to put them out later. We're going to put them out later. So that's scenario number one. You will have to go back and get that. All right. Scenario number one. Here's scenario number two. All right. Mary and Lisa have been friends for over 10 years. Catch this. We're going to the word. We'll get it. For all you word people, I'm one of them too. We're going to the word on this and we're going to give you some principles and we're going to get off in record breaking time. Mary and Lisa have been friends for over 10 years. Let's get in this and had a great relationship, right? About a couple months ago, the two had a small disagreement about a matter. And over the course of the past couple of months, Lisa has barely spoken with Mary and has witnessed some pretty noticeable changes with her friend and their interactions. Well, as of recently, Mary checked her Facebook account and noticed that Lisa has unfriended her as well. Mary wants to mention it to Lisa, but doesn't want Lisa to take it wrong. So she doesn't really know where to start. Now that's scenario number two, the friends, Mary and Lisa. Again, on socials, we'll be talking about this all day, off into tomorrow's session. All right, here's scenario number three. I'm gonna give you this, right? Chad loves the Lord and volunteers on the Willing to Do Anything ministry within his church. As he's diligently working, doing whatever he can to build up the ministry, he meets Raul, who says that he's on the Willing to Do Anything ministry as well. And as time goes along, Chad notices that Raul shows up infrequently, does a half job, and has quite a bad attitude when relating to others. Now, Chad recognizes that Raul has been at the ministry longer than him and doesn't quite know how to go about handling this situation. All right, Chad and Raul. Again, we'll be talking about this all day on socials. I want you all to get engaged and activated because we want to get down to the bottom of resolving conflict. All right, so today's session, conflict resolution. Are y'all ready? Let's go there. Now, we're taught a lot of skills, right? In life, skills to cook. I know that my grandfather was a chef. My father took after him. And in the kitchen, I saw my father making biscuits from scratch. Everything was from scratch, right? And so I learned how to cook. And many of you learn the recipes of your family and learn all kinds of things from the family unit. But what we're going to talk about today, conflict resolution, sometimes has not been learned. Why? Because that's one of the relationship, sessions that no one ever sits us down. I don't know about you, but maybe it happened in your upbringing, but no one ever sat most of us down and said, this is what you do in this instance. This is how you navigate around this. When this comes up, that happens. When this happens in your money, do this. This happens in a friendship, do this. This is the kind of person you want to marry. This is the kind of thing that you don't want to do with your husband. This is the kind of thing that you want to do with your wife. This is how you raise your children. Many of us just had to figure it out as we went along. But whether economically, relationally, sexually, emotionally, we can all agree today that the world is broken. And because the world is broken, watch this, many times our relationships can get broken. Now, you know, walking around with unhealthy relationships in our lives causes unhappiness and a lack of peace and a lack of joy, you know, being stressed out and battling to walk in purpose. And so God wants, he is a God of relationship. Come on, for God so what? Loved the world. Come on, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but have what? Everlasting life. That's probably one of the first Sunday school lessons that we learned, John 3 and 16. But that was all about giving himself in relationship for a people that may not even see his worth or value. And many times, you know, when it comes to relationships, that can be the issue, is the fact that sometimes we have people in our life that don't know necessarily how to treat us because they don't necessarily know us. And so a relationship is not just meeting a person one day, but it's the ins and outs. It's the nuances of going through the mountains and the valleys, the good times and the bad times, being able to weather certain storms and have certain conversations that may not be as easy as others, but yet maintaining the purpose and trajectory of that relationship and staying on course throughout the seasons of life. That's a real friend. Oh, a real friend has to be tested and tried. Come on, real family. I'm not talking about just titles, has to be tested and tried. I want to see how you handle conflict and how you handle the seasons and how you handle having a job and having not having a job. I before I say that I love you and before I say that you're my friend, come on, somebody here, before I just pull you into my family unit and allow you to go into my refrigerator, come on, somebody, and sleep over at the house, and before you call me dad and I call you son, or before it's a daughter and a father relationship, a mother and a father, come on, whether it's spiritually or naturally, we have to be able to weather the storm and go through conflict. You know, I'll be honest with you. Some of the things that we wrestle with in our relationships, couldn't it, I'm just going to ask you a question here. Couldn't it not be some of the things, just some of the things, could it not be worked out in if we just were able to sit around the table and ask the right questions and not make up the scenario in our mind and just really sit down and have a conversation based off of what actually happened? Yeah, but many times that's not the thing that happens. Right? There's an unforgiveness there. There may be a bitterness there. There may be an avoidance there. And we never do sit around at the table. So we spend 5 years, come on, dialoguing in our head, going around, not close. There's an elephant in the room because we refuse, for whatever reason, to sit down, or that person refuses to sit down and have a couple minute conversation, which could alleviate 5 years of dysfunction. See, we're trying to say we don't have time. I just, come on, put in the feet. I just don't have time. I don't have time. I don't have time for foolishness. I don't have time for the games. I don't have time for the he said, the she said. I don't have time for, well, they rolled their eyes at me. They didn't hug me. I don't think they like me. Listen, sit down and have a conversation. Sit down, and all you're getting, get an understand. I don't have time for all of that messy stuff, the silly stuff, the stuff that just don't make sense, the stuff that we could talk out, that we're sitting here mad over nothing, upset over nothing, conflicted over nothing. Let's sit down and handle some of this stuff. I don't have time. I don't have time. I don't, you better get somebody in here. This is going to be good this morning. I've already got a feeling that everything is going to be all right. Now, watch this. It's the damage that unresolved conflict causes, right? It's the damage that unresolved conflict causes. In other words, unresolved conflict causes damage. All right. Are you ready? Let's go there. Let's go there. All right. I want to start in 1 John really quickly. Let's get this as foundation, right? Here's the first thing, and I think we need to write this down for those that have notes and stuff like this. I want to give you some things that are really going to stick with us this morning, all right, that are really going to stick with us this morning. Praise God. All right, 1 John begins to talk about the fact that it unresolved conflict blocks our fellowship with God. Unresolved conflict, right, blocks our fellowship with God. So why is it important that I get stuff straight with people, right? Because my horizontal relationships have a vertical effect. Whew, good God, have mercy. It is impossible to be good with God and not be good with people. Okay, all right, all right. Did you get that? It is impossible to be good with God and not be good with people, okay? Because the first point is it blocks our relationship with God, right? So here it is. Let's keep running. Verse number 13, chapter number 4, 1 John, right? This is how we know, this is the NIV, that we live in him and him in us, that he has given us of his spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. It's talking about the relationship with God the Father and God the Son, right? The Godhead. The Father sent his Son into the world, right? Verse number 15, if anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they live in God. So we know and rely on the love that God has for us. Somebody say love. Love, love, love. Love is, and this is not talking about philia. This is not talking about eros. This is actually talking about agape, right? The kind of love that unconditionally is resilient. The kind of love that you can go through a conflict and I'll still be here. The kind of love that doesn't run you down in your absence. The kind of love that we can go through something and it doesn't change my perspective on the purpose of our relationship. The kind of love that goes through the fire and comes out, my God, pure as gold. I'm talking about the agape love. He says here, God is love, and whosoever, verse number 16, lives in love in God and God in them. Verse number 17, this is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have the confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out, KJV version says, cast out all fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love, but we love because he first loved us. Okay, right there, right there. See, we need to get that. The reason why I agape is not because of what you do or what you don't do. It is not what you provide. It is not what you don't provide. The reason I have agape that I operate in is because God first loved me. So this helps us to be able to overcome people that may do us wrong, that even if you do me wrong, I'm not going to step into the lower recesses of your behavior and pay you back according to what you did, because that's not the standard for my life. The standard for my life is agape. My God, let me just throw this in here too, that everybody you love, you don't necessarily have to reconnect with. All right, let me, Lord have mercy. Everybody you love, you don't have to necessarily call them on the phone every 2 seconds, every waking second. Everybody you love doesn't mean that you have to have an up close and personal relationship with. There are some people that you love but aren't healthy for your everyday lifestyle, but you can still love them. Come on, it doesn't mean you hate them, doesn't mean that you're trying to sabotage them, doesn't mean that you're trying to stab them in the back, doesn't mean that you're trying to pay them back. They can do whatever they do, but as for me and, okay, all right, I thought y'all saw it. As for me and my house over here, we're going to serve the Lord. And you can act like you act over there, but we're going to love. We're going to stay in love. And I'm not talking about a feeling. I'm talking about the reality. And you have to make up your mind that whatever you do and whatever you say and however you act and however you talk about me and however you try to stab me in the back and however I believe that no weapon that is formed against me shall be able to prosper. And I don't need to change my position with God for how you are trying to do me at this present moment. Say, it changes. So I can't block my fellowship with God. I have to stay in love. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Come on, put that in the feed. Stay in love. Remain in love. Don't fall out of this place of love. All right. For verse number 20 says, whoever claims to love God yet hate. Okay. Right here. We got to deal with this. Are y'all ready this morning? We've got to drop right on down in the reality of what this word is saying. Now, this ain't me. This is God's word. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So verse number 20, whoever claims to love God, but hates his brother and sister is a liar. Okay. For whosoever, verse number 20, does not love their brother and their sister whom they have seen, cannot love God whom they have not seen. In other words, let me just make it plain. If you are not in love, now I'm not talking about the Eros love. Let me put that a different way. If you find it difficult, right, to love people based on what they do to you, right? If you find it difficult and you have hate in your heart against a brother or sister or anyone, the Bible calls you a liar when it comes to you loving God. Because the first point here is that our hatred or our mistreatment of people blocks our fellowship with God. It is impossible to be in harmony with God and not be in harmony with people. Oh, that's going to change some things for us. I don't want you to get off the broadcast right there. They're talking about, well, I won't be listening to this one. No, hang on, baby. You're going to be all right. Take this. I know it's a rocky road right here, but you've got to get some things together in your relationships. You've got to have some conversations. You've got to get some things out of your heart. That's why David said it. David knew because he was a prophet, king and priest, and he was used to dealing with people as an individual that was anointed by God. And even David had to say, Lord, there's some things that ain't right with me. I wish I had somebody here. There's some things that I'm struggling with, and it ain't this, that, and the other. It's with people. Come on. And he says, Lord, create in me. I wish I had somebody here. A clean heart. And then renew within me the right spirit. David said, my heart didn't got janky. There's some people that did some stuff to me. There's some things that I did to myself. I didn't got involved with this, that, and the other. Lord, I just need a heart renovation. Just go ahead and cleanse my heart, purify my heart, create within me a clean heart, David says. Then renew the right spirit within me. Then I'll be able to this, that, and the other. See, sometimes we're fulfilling roles and duties, and we have titles, and we're functioning for God, but don't really have the solidarity of having relationship with God. This is one of the factors that pull us out of the functional religious context and actually line us up with biblical relationship with God. Does this make sense? And with people. So it blocks our fellowship with God. Number two, why shouldn't I have unresolved conflict within my life? It prevents and hinders my prayers from being answered. All right. It prevents and hinders my prayers from being answered. Matthew chapter number six. Matthew chapter number six. All right. And we understand this. It is the Lord's Prayer. Matthew chapter number six, verse number 5-8 talks about the Lord's Prayer. 9 initiates the Lord's Prayer. And I'll read this in KJV because it's going to sound more like what we came up on. All right. He says this. He says, After this manner, verse number 9, therefore pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. We're familiar with that, right? Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right, let's go back up, because we're going to get verse number 12, and then we'll hit verse number 14. Watch this. And forgive us our debts as we, in the similitude that we forgive other people, Lord, forgive me. If I don't forgive them, Lord, hold it against me. If I forgive them, Lord, you're going to forgive me. So he says, in the same manner, right? This is the prayer. In the same manner that your forgiveness of other people is instituted, that's how God is going to forgive you. So now, if you hold stuff against people, God is going to hold stuff against what? You. So the conflict management is that parallel. It hinders our prayers and prevents our prayers from being answered. We go down in verse number 14, and it makes it very clear. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Verse number 15, but if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Right? My God. I think it's very clear. I think it's very clear that if someone has stuff in their hearts to get rid of it, as a person, me, I don't like holding on to stuff. Like, you know, if some of that subliminal stuff that people do on Facebook, and we call it in the Midwest, nice, nasty. Praise the Lord. Praise God. God bless you. And it's like, come on, can we just get around that and just talk about what's really going on? But you know, you got to put on the church semantics and things like that. And so, you know, when you get to a certain maturity, you don't over spiritualize or hyper spiritualize a thing. You find the time, and we'll talk about how to do conflict management, because there's some people that don't know how to do it either. But I refuse to be nice, nasty. Come on, somebody. And I realize now, according to the word in Matthew chapter number 6, that unresolved conflict can prevent and even hinder my prayers. Y'all all right? Yeah. All right. Number 3, it hinders our happiness. So number 1, it blocks our fellowship with God. Number 2, why do we need to have a conflict resolution? Because it can prevent and hinder my prayers from being answered. And then number 3, it hinders my happiness. All right. So I want to give you just the first thing, right? If there is a situation that is happening, right? What do I do? Where do I start? How do I handle it? Now, I'm not talking about what they do. How do I handle it? All right. So the first thing is you have to make the first step. All right. Make the first step. Come on, put that in the feed really quickly. Make the first step. Mm-hmm. Make the first step. Yes. Come on. Absolutely. Yes, Lord, make the first step. Yeah. Yeah. Because watch this. It's not if conflict is going to happen, come on, within the context of our homes, but It's when it's going to happen. Somebody's going to say something. Somebody's going to do something. Somebody's going to act in a way. Something's going, you know, something's going to happen. So we need these tools, not only for us, come on, but teaching our children, teaching, come on, setting up a culture within our homes, setting up a culture within our churches, setting up a culture within our ministries to say, hey, we're not going to go into worship. Come on, with dirty hearts. We're not going to try to worship over and praise over a conflict. We're not going to have meetings. And come on, these are, watch this. I'll be honest with you. This is just one of the tenets of being a mature Christian. This is just one of the tenets. Yeah, you know how you growing up in God? Not how fast you can speak in tongues, not the style of how you can worship, not the fact that a tear comes out your right eye. Come on, when your song comes on, that's not mature in God. When you know that you are growing up, come on, in the grace of God, when someone does you wrong and you refuse to act like you used to act, come on, you know how to do it now. Oh yeah, you know how to do it. You know how to act a complete fool. Come on, you know how to act. Come on, in the way that you used to act when you was out in the streets, when you wasn't on this side, come on, of the kingdom, when you didn't have God in your life. And so salvation doesn't erase what you remember you doing, but salvation, come on, puts a love for God in there that transcends the situation. So you know that you're growing up in God when you can look at the situation that you used to fall to. I wish I had at least 10 people right here. And you said, listen, we ain't going that way no more. We ain't doing that. See, some of us ought to praise God this morning. Hallelujah. And that's how you know that you're growing in the grace of God, is that stuff that you would have did 5, even 3, even 10 years ago. You ain't falling for the same stuff. You're not cussing like you used to. Come on. You're not going to the trunk. Come on. You're not getting that switchblade. Y'all ain't saying that. You ain't calling. You ain't gossiping like you used to. Why? Because I love God more. Come on, at this juncture of my life, and I want to please him. See, that's the standard right there. I don't want to please people. I don't want to get in a situation where I'm flippy floppy, depending on who it is. This is my standard. This is just who I am. And I know I'm growing in the grace of God because I'm not the same person that I used to be. I wish I had 10 people right here. I wish I had 10 people that could testify. Come on, release your testimony on that feed and declare, I'm not the same person. I am not the same person. I love God for real. I'm not the same person. I want to please God with all of my life. I'm not the same person. I ain't got time for cussing and fussing and being upset and being hateful and being vengeful. Come on. And trying to repay and retribution and all that. Come on, somebody. That was the form of me. Now don't push me to the edge now. Don't push me to the edge because I hadn't forgot, but the Lord has saved, watch this, and sanctified me. In other words, he's pulled me away from my previous existence. And I honestly can say that I'm different now on this side. Come on, testify it. I love God for real. I'm not the same person. Mm-mm. Matter of fact, you don't even want to know her. Mm-mm. You don't want to know him. Mm-mm. Don't put me in position where they have to come to the city. Don't put me in position where they have to drive up real quick or make a one-way flight. Don't do that because they're in there. Come on, Paul even wrestled with the fact that he says, watch this. He says, I want to do the right thing. He says, evil is present. He says, but Lord, watch this. Here's the Nesbitology of it all. Lord, help me. I've got choices that I could make, but help me to make the right choice. Lord, have mercy. Let's get out of that. Come on my job today. Help me to make the right choice. Come on, as I'm going to the university today, help me to make the right choice. As I'm talking with my wife and husband, Lord, help me to be led by your spirit and make the right choices. God, as I'm talking with my children, as I'm in here and there, and I'm going everywhere, help me, God, to be led by you, because I always want to bring you glory in whatever space that I'm in. Come on, somebody here. Help me to make the right choices. Help me to say the right things. Help me to do the right things. Help me to think the right way. Help me to respond as you would respond. That's it, Chastity. I love it. I love it, Jessica. I love it. Come on, Keith. Help us up and down this timeline. Yeah, but we have to make the right, we have to make the first step. All right. We have to make the first step. I'm going to give you just this one thing, and then we're going to dialogue. I won't give you a million things. We have to make the first step. Ah, Yerebo Shanda. When it comes to conflict, it's not going to solve itself. Okay. It's not going to happen accidentally. Right? The only way to solve a conflict is to face it. All right? The only way to solve a conflict is to face it. All right? We have to deal with our fear of the conflict and the perceived negative outcome. So, in other words, don't allow what you think another person would say. Come on, in playing a scenario in your head. Well, if I come to them and I try to work it out, I know they're going to say this. And if I do this, I know they're going to do that. And if I move this way, then I know that they're going to do no. Let's not play it over in our head. Let's pray about it. Let's speak to God about it. Yeah, yeah. Watch this. Before you speak to them, speak to God. Did you get that? When I believe when the word, let me find this. This is for somebody today. Somebody needs to hold on. Isaiah 45:2 today, all day, all week, as you go into this holiday season, right? He says, I will go before you. Come on. Talk to God before you talk to them, and I will make your crooked places straight. Woo! He says, when you talk to God, before you talk to them, he says, before you even get there, I'm going to work it out. Before you get there, I'm going to soften their heart. Isaiah 45:2. You need to hold on to that. I'm going to go before you and fine tune some things. I'm going to go before you and shut their anger down. I'm going to go before you and make a raging water peaceable. I'm getting ready to work out the situation. I don't know who this is for. I don't know who this is for, but I'm getting ready to work it out before you even get there. And by the time you get there, all you're going to have to do is thank God for the end result. You thought it was going to be a fight, but by the time you get there, they're already in tears. The Holy Ghost is already dealing with them. Come on. They're already, come on. He didn't show them a dream. He didn't gave them something and broke them entirely down. And you're thinking that you're going to have to go ahead there and you think it's going to be a fight, but God says, I've already went before you. Isaiah 45. And verse 2, and I've made the crooked place straight. So before we talk to them, we better talk to God. Woo! This is for 7 people. God's done already worked it out. I know that's country. I know it's completely backwoods Alabama. Look, God done already worked it out. It's already done. It's already fixed. It's already resolved. Yeah. All right. Go write this in the feed as well. Genesis 3:10. Genesis 3:10. All right. Sometimes the fear of conflict makes individuals distant, defensive, and demanding. All right. This is Adam in the garden, and he said, I heard thy voice twice. I heard that voice in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. Understand that sometimes it's not even you. It's individuals' fear of the conflict that makes them act like they act. And so the fear of conflict can make individuals distant, defensive, and even demanding. All right. So how do you deal with the fear of conflict? Very quickly. And I'm giving you these things. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, God has not given what? Me a spirit of fear, but that of power, huh? Love and a sound mind. Mm-hmm. 1 John 4:18 says that perfect love casts out all what? Fear. When our love becomes greater than our fear, it's called courage. I'm going to say that 3 times. When our love becomes greater than our fear, it's called courage. One more time, Nesbitt. When your love becomes greater than your fear, it's called courage. And God has given somebody the courage to step into a place of reconciliation. Because I believe that God is restoring unto you the years that the canker worm, come on somebody, and the palmer worm and the caterpillar has eaten it up. Come on, that great army is going to have to spit it back out. And this is your season of total restoration. Guess what? He's going to restore your house. He's going to restore your money. He's going to restore your faith. He's going to restore your mind. He's going to restore your energy. He's going to restore your health. But watch this. He's also, if we're going to have total restoration, he's also going to restore broken relationships. I wish I had somebody here. I said, he's going to fix what looks like it can't be fixed. He's going to do what looks like, my God, could never be done in 1,000 years. I'm telling you, if we're shouting total restoration, best believe that the things that have been broken, God's going to come in and repair those things. I wish I had somebody here. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Fathers, come on. That have had conflicts with daughters, daughters that have had conflicts with mothers, mothers that have conflicts with daughters, come on, sons, come on, and all in the family, there's conflicts and things that have happened and short-circuited, my God, and this went that way, and that went that way, and this happened in 92, and that happened in 2004, my God, but God is bringing this thing full circle. I wish y'all would hear me today, and this is why I believe that the Lord would not allow me to get off of this. He says, listen, if I'm going to do total restoration and you're going to walk in the full measure of everything I've given you, why you think I'm going to restore your money, your health, my God, in every other area, but I'm not going to touch that relationship. He says, I'm going before you, Isaiah, my God, 45:2, and I'm going to make your crooked place straight. And I don't want you to have the fear of failure, because in everything else, my God, you have that courage. But he says, I want you to get the courage, because I'm about to restore, I'm about to repair, and I'm going to allow there to be reconciliation within the relationships. And if you believe that, I need as many ones that you could put up in this feed as possible right there. Total restoration. Total restoration. He's going to give it all back. My God, today. He's going to give it all back. Hallelujah. I need to see some ones. Listen. I'm not leaving out of 2022 broken, busted, disgusted, frustrated, muted. Come on, silent. Come on, Lord, if you're going to put it all back together, I need every area of my life reflecting your glory. I need every area of my life reflecting your goodness. I want my marriage to reflect it. I want every relationship to reflect it. I want my spiritual life to reflect it. I want my physical body to reflect it. God, your glory, nothing missing, nothing lacking, nothing broken in my home. I dare you to declare that family matters. Family matters. Sometimes you got to fight for it. Yeah, they're stubborn. Yes, they have an attitude. Yes, it doesn't erase the fact that they did wrong. Yes, yes, they got some ways about them. But the Lord says their souls too. He says, just like I'm working on you, I'm working on them. And I'm getting ready to do my greatest work in the family. He says, yes, I'm bringing the family back together. Good God, have mercy. Family matters. I'm bringing the family back together. Ooh. So this is going to be a notable sign that the Lord is moving in an amazing way. And I'm just going to leave it right there and not go any further. This is going to be a notable sign. And I'm going to tell you this, stuff that could not be worked out in 20 years, 15 years, stuff that, my God, has been going on for 10 years, 5 years, and even generationally, let me say that, stuff that has been happening generationally and even that other stuff is going to be instantly resolved. I wish I had somebody up in here. The Lord says, I'm resolving it. I just hear that word. I'm resolving it. Resolve, resolve, resolve. Shakato rababasa. I resolve. Woo, glory to God. Andobo hoshai. My God, resolve, resolve. I never will forget. I'm going to tell you this, and we're out of here for today. I never will forget because God's doing it in the family this morning. My God, he's bringing resolve to marriages. He's bringing resolve to sister and sister relationships. He's bringing resolve to father and daughter relationships. He's bringing resolve, my God, to son and father relationships. There's a resolve coming, come on, through the generations and that stuff that the other family dealt with and that age category, come on, sons and daughters and previous and upcoming generations are not going to have to deal with those things. Curses are being broken. My God, difficulties are going now. I never will forget when we moved from Illinois, the Chicago area to the West Coast. I was in a gym. Listen, I was in a gym one day, real strange, right? I was in a gym, hallelujah, and I knew this one person, and they knew that, of course, I was a preacher and pastor and this and that and the other, and I didn't really unfold to them everything that I was doing, but they were in the air, and they were excited. They said, I want you to meet somebody. So I'm in an LA Fitness, and God is my witness. In an LA Fitness, and they said, I want you to meet someone. So I go around the corner and I walk with them, and there's this hair salon in the LA Fitness. So we have LA Fitness is down here, big gym. And they said, this is the only hair salon in the LA Fitness within our entire brand in this particular area. I said, wow, okay, great. They said, I want you to meet this person. So I step into the hair salon, and here's this woman. And I feel this feeling like the anointing. You know how you be in church and you know, the anointing starts moving, whether it's goosebumps, but there's a presence. Yeah. So I step into the hair salon and there's this presence. And the lady says, I've been waiting for you. I've been waiting for you. And I said, oh, okay, here it is. And right then I asked the Lord, I said, is she a prophet? Because I can sense the presence on her. And he says, and I will tell you. So she gives me a story. She says, I've been waiting for you. And she says, my son went to prison. She says he went to prison for just a little while because he had a case. This is going to make sense. Stay with me for the next 30 seconds. He went to prison because he had a case. They said that he was intoxicated and ran over a man. They said he ran over a man, and so they threw him into prison because they thought he killed the man. So he sat there a number of months, almost a year, because they didn't have the correct footage. One day they call her and said, there's been a new development in the case. There's been a new development in the case, and we think you ought to know about it. So they informed her what the development was. The development was, she's telling me this. I'm meeting this person for the first time. I'm in the salon. I'm there for the first time. And they said they've been waiting on me, right? This is real life. This is not a dream. This is real life. I'm in a new region. They've been waiting on me, okay? So she starts telling me about this case, and they said the new evidence is the fact that we've got footage to prove that someone had, watch this, I know it's early, but someone had killed the man and thrown him into the street. So that when your son turned on that street and started driving down that street, he ran over someone that had already been killed. This was a year in. He had been sitting in prison. And they just got the new evidence. They said, ma'am, he says, you can expect within the next 30 days that there's going to be a release. Because what we thought, what the district attorney thought actually happened, did not happen, and we have new evidence. Shh, Lord have mercy. She turns around and looks at me, and she says this. She says, and yes, she says, and the Lord had to get you out of one region to put you in another. Shh. My God, she says there's new evidence that points to the fact that God is opening up new things for you. Now, I want to tell you, the reason I told you that is because I believe that just like she told me that, and watch this. And so the Lord told me at the end, he says, she's a prophet that hasn't been, that her gift has not been sanctified. Woo, did you hear that? Did you hear that? No, she wasn't a church prophet. She wasn't nobody that was going to stand up on a Sunday morning, but that gift of the prophetic had flowed through her bloodline and rested upon her. So she was a prophet with an unsanctified gift. And she read me that day. Call it a reading if you want to, call it a medium, a psychic, whatever you call. But she saw something. Now watch this. And the Lord began to tell me, he said, I can use anybody to tell you about what's about to happen in your life next. He says, don't limit me to a church prophet that lines you up in the middle of the church. Come on. And I'm not saying that I go for read. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying to you, that when it is your season of total restoration, when it is your season of release, when it is your season to get it all back, when it is your season that God says the losing days are going to be over and your winning days are here, he will allow somebody that don't even know you to announce your next season. Good God, Hammer. I'm telling you right now. The Lord wouldn't allow me to get off of this as surely as I told you that story. The Lord wouldn't allow me to get off of this because he says that there are some more, there are individuals that are in our homes, there are individuals that are in our families that need a release. And just like that young man got a release from an unexpected place at an unexpected time, you can believe it and stand on it. I don't know who will. My God, but I need you to believe and stand on it. By the time this year is over, you're going to hear about incredible, ridiculous, unusual, supernatural. The conflict is over, baby. All you're going to have to do is pull them out. All you're going to have to do is hug them. All you're going to have to do is put a plan to put it back together. There's some people, God have mercy, I'm prophesying by the Spirit of God. This is going to be your first year with people that you hadn't sat down, family that you hadn't sat down with for years. Because there is an anointing, I wish you would get it today, of total restoration that is upon this session. And it goes out to you now. Shokota rebaso, it goes out to you now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Release. Release. There's a release. There's a release coming. We thank you for it. I know I'm over my time. We bless you for it. We thank you for it. We bless you for it. Come on, just declare it. Declare release. Father, thank you for the release of sons and daughters. Thank you for the release of captives. Thank you for the release of our family members. Thank you that wherever the conflict has been, that you are Isaiah 45 and toing us. You are making our crooked places straight by going before us. Holy Spirit of God, we thank you this week. We give you permission to work out what we can't work out, to do what we cannot do, to go where we cannot go, to resolve what we cannot fix, to handle what is impossible for us. Spirit of the living God, we pray that you'd fall upon us and our families, God, in the name of Jesus this week, and allow something unusual and supernatural to happen to cause a wind. God, in the name of Jesus, I heard that, God. Hallelujah. He's saying, my God, there will be no more losses. There's a win for the wind, my God. There's a W-I-N-D coming, my God, to release a W-I-N. There's a wind. He said a wind of winds is coming. Shako robo sha. And I'm about to blow them upon your life. I'm about to blow over your marriage. I'm about to blow upon your sons and daughters. I'm about to blow, my God, and things that would have tried to take them. He says the wind that was scheduled to take them off of course is going to be the same wind that shoves them back into alignment. Oh God, because I'm hallelujah, glory. I felt that in my spirit, hallelujah. He says, I'm redirecting, glory to God, the winds. I'm redirecting, hallelujah, the wind. I'm redirecting, hallelujah. If I could do it at the bottom of the boat while I am sleeping, my God, and come up to the top and say winds and waves, come on, and have the testimony that it is even the winds and the waves that do obey him. He says, I'm into the redirection of winds, and the wind that was scheduled to throw them off course by the enemy is the wind that I'm going to redirect for my glory, and I'm going to push you into a further alignment, you and your house, you and your family. And so we thank you, God, for redirecting the winds today. We want to thank you, God, that what was scheduled for our detriment is going to shove us into our betterment. We want to thank you, God, hallelujah, that in times like this, you're bringing broken lives back together, and you're mending us for your glory, God, and you're bringing the family unit, and you're strengthening, and you're saying, I'm getting ready to get some glory out of this. I'm getting ready to get some glory out of this. And we want to thank you today, and we give you glory because we agree with you, God. We agree with your plan. We agree with your word. We agree with your move. And we want to thank you for doing it in advance. In the name of Jesus. In the name, come on, of Jesus. In the name, come on, God. He's after a hard case this morning. I heard him. He said, I'm going to deal with the hard cases. Hey, katalabokosha. In the name, hallelujah, of Jesus. And we give you praise for it in Jesus' name. If you believe that for your household, if you believe that family matters, I need you to put a one up in the feed and do it. Put as many ones. Watch this. Do it. Put the ones up for every single person in your family. So if you got five people in your family, put five ones. If you got two people in your family, put two ones. If you got eight people in your family, I need eight ones, because God's saying, I'm going in and I'm getting ready to touch every single individual under your roof. My family matters. Come on, do it right now. Thank you for it. Thank you for it. You're making a declaration. You are decreeing that the enemy can't have my babies. You're decreeing that the enemy can't have my children. You're decreeing that the enemy can't have my relationships. You're decreeing the enemy can't have my wife. You're decreeing the enemy can't have my husband. You're decreeing that the enemy cannot steal what God has blessed me with. Father, thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, glory to God. Oh my God, this thing stirs me. Bless you. Blessings to you. Blessings to you. Listen, we've got to move and get off of here. Listen, go and be blessed. There's a wind that's shifting you into a WIN. Listen, Christmas in Ghana, the interest meeting, so many great things happening around the Pivot community this particular week. And of course, we're praying for you and yours. Some will be traveling and individuals will be traveling to you. You'll be traveling to them. And we're praying that God would give you safe travels. But stop over to our social media. We're going to engage today with those scenarios. I need you to pledge. Okay, there'll be a link there to pledge for the Christmas in Ghana. And also on December 3rd, I need all of my people that are in Amarillo. We've been plowing and plowing and doing inventory and doing this and that. And the Lord says now it is time to have an interest meeting. So we're going to answer questions and provide vision and insight and all of the kinds of things. I'm excited. Hope that you're excited about what God desires to do. Go back. Make sure that you tag somebody in this Family Matters. Listen, this thing has been on fire, and I appreciate what the Lord is doing. Listen, God bless you. We'll talk to you soon. Have an amazing day in Jesus' name. Take care. Safe.